growingyourgreens.com to have another exciting episode for you. In this episode, we're going to share with you guys a really cool garden and a new way to grow some medicinal herbs, right? I've shown you guys in the past how you could grow it in a big hole with like the TD series last year. But honestly, guys, as much as I love TD and he's doing some great stuff and sharing a lot of good info with you guys, it may not be a practical way to grow, the medicinal herb for most people, because you know it takes he invests a lot of time to his girls to grow big, huge, giant trees, to prune them, to pull them and play with them and do it really right, you know, to maximize the yield but also the quality. So what I want to show you guys is a different way to grow medicinal herbs, whether you want to grow cannabis or otherwise, and it's just in your standard raised bed gardens, right? Honestly, guys, this is how I would grow cannabis along with my other vegetables, because to me it's not any kind of special plant we should worship or hail or anything. It's just another herb on the planet put here by God or whomever you believe in that by proven science has some medicinal benefits. I personally don't like to get the high effect or the intoxication effect personally, but I do like all the other health benefits from the cannabis. But look at this, guys, this is cool. Throwing the cannabis right here next to the sugar snap peas that have been growing all winter, right? This is truly the way to have living soil, because like literally this bed is never fallow, it's never empty. There's always real other vegetables growing in it, and even that diversity of vegetables. So, you know, hey, I love living soil, and living soil is great, and doing a living soil cover crop, a can of sewer crop is great, but what's even better than a can of sewer crop is growing all different kinds of plants, because every different plant will send down different root exudates that'll feed different soil microbes to improve your soil. So, I mean, in this bed, he's got spinach, he's got the sugar snap peas, he's got the strawberries over here. Over on this side, he's got the calendulas. Calendulas are edible. I just ate one of those. He's got lettuce in here. He's got some squash growing in there. He's got a cucumber in here. He's got more plant starts going out. This cannabis is going to go in the bed here pretty soon. So he's growing a diversity of things. I mean, look, this bed, he has carrots, more sugar snap peas, and check it out, cannabis plant in with the kale, right next to the kale. I mean, seriously, guys, this is 12 inches away. And then he's got the wasabi arugula going on right here, flowering right now. The sunflowers in the back, they're gonna get nice and tall. And of course, for your living soil, you gotta have some mulch. So he's mulching here with his grass from his lawn. And check this out, this is his cannabis plant, but let's lift it up. Look at that. That's some living soil right there, guys, when you like lift it up and you see earthworms right underneath where the plant is. This is some good soil right here, guys. Look at that. All right, so what I really like here at Teal Farm, which essentially is just this guy's backyard, is that he's really trying to like grow a lot of things together next to each other, but like look nice at the same time. So check this out, he's got a wine barrel and he's got like strawberries planted around it. And then he's just got a cannabis plant in there, an autoflower currently flowering. But then also like behind, look, he's got like different raspberries and berry plants going off too. And then down below the pot, you know, he's also got more strawberries happening on there, you know? So, I mean, this is how nature works. Nature is not a monoculture, right? So growing six cannabis plants in your backyard is great. But what I think is even better is growing plants together with other different kinds of plants, right? No human likes to be left in isolation, right? We all like to be in community. So do the plants. And more importantly, in my opinion, so does the soil. The soil likes a lot of different roots going into it, and the microbes should just flourish. So what I want to do in this episode is we're going to go ahead and show you guys actually how he starts some of the plants that actually end up in his garden, including maybe his, cloning and his mothers that he's got going on, to ensure that he has, you know, good quality females. And then we're also gonna show you guys some of the nutrients he adds to create his living soil. And then at the end, we're gonna go ahead and interview Seth about his living soil so that you guys could learn more about how he grows his cannabis, which is a lot different than how I've shown it grown in the past. All right, so this is where it all starts. Since we are here in the springtime, right, he's got his baby plant starts, sun gold tomatoes, bucholoca. You can see he's like really anal about labeling everything. He's got some cannabis mixed into some of these pots, and then also he's got them, you know, it's all on a heat mat, and he's got the little lights here And you can see he's got under this little humidity dome too. Look at those little babies, how nice they look. To the grower here, the cannabis is just another plant that should be treated just like another vegetable, right? And this is what we all need to get over. We're like elevating this cannabis plant to some special status. And really, it's just another vegetable or herb that you should grow along with your vegetables. Now, aside from starting his own seeds, he also has some other plants that I want to show you guys real quick. All right, check it out, guys. We got the Ultra HD by Seville Classics from Amazon, nonetheless. And check it out. This is his little grow room in a box. So he's got the white rose LED lights right here. It's generating some nice heat. And first, I want to show you guys actually what he's got up top. So check it out, because it's nice and warm in this little box, right? He's got little seedlings going, lupins and different kind of vegetables. Here's some super hot peppers right there going on. He's also got some blue lights here. These are like bug lights for like fungus gnats and different bugs. Got two different kind of catchers. The main thing on these catchers, I was actually just researching this a while back, that like you need to have the right nanometer of light, right? A lot of these things are like bogus because they don't have the right nanometer for the bug that you want to attract. Anyways, but going right down, nice and bright. He has a dehumidifier in here should he need it. He's growing in these air prune pots that he likes a lot because they just basically auto prune and get some nicer root growth in there. Of course, he's got the standard fabric pots going on. He's got some vegetables down in here as well. But basically, these are his mothers that he's growing out that he'll take clones of so he could have the same exact genetics. He's got a lot of cool stuff on here. Look at this. This is actually called Freak Show Fern Cannabis. I really love how the leaves look. I want to actually just eat these leaves in a salad, so I'm looking forward to how these are going to grow out in the future. But basically, he comes in here and he'll just prune off any large leaves on the bottom. So we're just going to go ahead and clip one off. Check it out. And you know what? How he uses his leaves, actually, he puts his leaves on the top of the soil to like act as a mulch. So he mulches his cannabis plants with the leaves. That being said, I don't know that I'd waste valuable cannabis leaves on mulching it because I'd rather eat it. And I want to encourage you guys, add some cannabis leaves when you're pruning them off to your salads, right? You don't have to make a salad out of cannabis leaves, but put a couple leaves in your salad, right? He's growing cannabis next to his lettuce. You could harvest lettuce, have a salad from lettuce, and have a half dozen or a dozen cannabis leaves mixed into the salad, chop them up and eat them so you guys can get the health benefits by not smoking it, right? That's what I really advocate for on my channel, guys. Cannabis is much more than just smoking it to get its intoxicating effects. It's got cannabinoids, terpenes, different kinds of phytochemicals and phytonutrients, vitamins and minerals, much like any other plant, as well as lots of documented science on its healing benefits. I love the compactness and just tautness of these plants. I mean, these are some nice, I mean, this is like a little tree here. This thing is so firm, it's totally insane. I love how he's growing these. He's got the ties in there to just make sure they grow how he wants them. And check this out, guys. He's got the micro irrigation going on here with all his drip tubing. He really gets into this stuff, man. All right, most important thing, much like you guys need to do with your vegetables, you guys need to harden off your plants. So don't just like take this plant that's pretty much ready to go out and get planted in the garden once the weather has warmed up appropriately. You know, it's like late April right now it's May as we film this right now. So you can't just put it out and put it in the ground. You want to harden your plants off. So basically, once it's to size inside the garage, he'll take it outside and he'll bring it outside and he'll just leave it outside in the garden in its pot for a couple hours each day for, several days in a row, including making sure it gets some nighttime activity when it gets the cold, because, living inside a box in a garage where it's nice and warm, right? This plant hasn't experienced the weather, the real sun. So much like with vegetables, you guys need to harden your plants off. It's super important because, you could lose them if you don't do this. And a lot of noobs just like, oh, I grow it inside, it's been growing so good. I put it outside and it died. What happened? It didn't harden it off, guys. All right, so I want to share with you guys a few things here in the garden. So he's hardening off some of his cannabis plant here and some other vegetables. But check this out, guys, like this cannabis is still pretty limp, right? And it was falling over. So what he did was something I'd never seen before. He took a pipe cleaner, right? And he just stuck it in the ground and he uses it basically as a stake that he could then wrap around the stem of the cannabis, or any vegetable for that matter, to keep it upright. So that's totally ingenious.
Now, the other thing I wanted to let you guys know about is his beds, right? So the one of the premises for living soil is that to have a living soil, you got to have at least 30 gallons worth of soil. So whether you're having a big fabric pot or digging into the ground, a little 30-gallon space, you could actually put in good soil and enrich and build the soil over time, right? So he's basically, he came into this house and it had these raised beds that were super tiny. So he basically got some more wood and he basically built on top of it to basically extend them up higher to create a more of a soil volume inside there, you know, because 30 gallons is the minimum, but the more the merrier, right? You want to have a soil party going on, you know, and if you're having a party in your house, you got a 10 by 10 room, you can't fit too many people in their party. The larger your house, the bigger the party, right? That's what he's doing with the soil here. More soil, more bacteria, more partying happening in the soil, right? And this is how he makes his living soil happen, right? Check it out. He's filled it up with some good soil and then he mulches really nicely. He's mixed in, you know, pesticide, herbicide-free straw with his grass clippings from right next door, right? So it didn't have to move that far. And check this out, we're just gonna move it to the side. And look at that, there's a worm right there. There's a worm right there, right? There's more worms in this soil than I've seen. Oh, there's another worm right there. There's more worms in this. Oh, there's another worm I just touched. There's two worms right there. There's more worms than even black soldier fly shell casings than I've seen at any other garden or farm I visited to date. So this is impressive. The techniques he uses, let's cover this back up, keep the worms happy. But check this out, in the middle here, he basically just takes his lettuce when the leaves go bad, and he'll just drop them in there and mix it in. So you guys can see there's like lettuce leaves. So this is like a totally unique and different way of mulching things. And look, he's got, you know, plants coming up right in between the mulching. And when he's ready to plant, he'll just move this stuff aside and plant right in the living soil. This is nice and moist. And look, more worms. I just moved that and like there's two worms, right? There's three worms right there. You don't have to look very far for the worms. That's definitely one good sign that you got some living soil. If you got a worm every time you move the soil away, right? And check this out. He's got lettuce planted here and he just planted a sun gold right in between there. This is a nice protected area for the sun gold to grow. I mean, today happens to be a little colder day. The sun's not out and it's probably gonna rain tomorrow. But yeah, I really love how he basically just interplants things really so close, all next to each other. I mean, this is the future of gardening and farming, right? It's basically having a little vegetable forest in your raised bed. So now I wanna go over with you guys actually how he builds some of this living soil and what's the specific soil recipe he uses to create some amazing soil. All right, so now I wanna share with you guys actually where the living soil starts here, because he's told me like, John, I didn't bring in bag soil by any large stretch to fill up my beds. I basically just made it all on site and I've been slowly adding it to my beds to raise up the levels over time. So that to me is really impressive because I just bring in soil. I don't have the time or the patience to make all my soil, although I do make a lot of compost that I add to my beds every single year. So I wanted to show you guys this setup here. This is a little composter that he got from Amazon, which basically you kind of put together and build. He had to stabilize it with some extra little poles here. And you look at the back here, he's got this big bin. So this is basically just a hopper for all his brown. So he's got leaves from his trees. He collects leaves in the neighborhood. And then mostly he's using shredded cardboard when his wife buys stuff and he buys stuff from Amazon and whatnot. I personally would shred the cardboard down to a little smaller consistency because to me this is still too large. It'll take a lot longer to break down. But obviously it's doing really good for him. So what he does is he'll basically take his greens and he'll like put it in here, such as like, you know, his roses here are greens. And then he'll just take a shit ton of cardboard and then cover them up, right? And just totally covered up. He's got a compost thermometer here to make sure things are happening right. And then when he's ready to harvest, right, this little box here has these little doors on the bottom. To me, this looks like some hokey ass Chinese stuff. But man, this thing is holding together. It's got nice aeration vents, right? And check this out, right? This stuff really works. We're gonna pull this up. Look at that. Underneath here, dude, the worms are coming out. When he wants soil, he just comes to here. And this is better soil than money could buy. You can't buy soil this good with this many worms in it, man, I want to take some of this soil home, dude. Look, worm, 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 worm. And look in there, there's tons of worms just going to town making his compost. This is truly the ultimate living soil, because not only does he take this soil, but he'll put some amendments in it and do other practices to make the soil even more living than it is coming right out of this composter. This is what we should all aspire to, is to make all the compost we need to use on site instead of bringing it in. I know a lot of you guys aren't there yet. I'm not even there, but he's doing it and he's making it happen. So that's really cool. So next I want to show you guys actually what he adds to the soil and other amendments and other practices he does to create some amazing living soil to grow his cannabis as well as his vegetables. All right, so another big component of creating a living soil is having some compost tea. And Boogie Brew is a living soil fuel of choice, according to Josh and Seth here. And that's what he's brewing here in this 5-gallon bucket. He's got this casting for growth aerator there, which is interesting because it basically uses like the tubing that is usually is basically like a sponge thing, and it basically just, he pumps air through it and it just bubbles on out. He's gonna have a weight on it to kind of keep it under the soil. And the cool thing about this setup, guys, check this out. This is a pump. This pump is plugged into a solar panel on top of his house, basically. Right now, it's only running at 25% because it's not that sunny of a day. But on a sunny day, he could crank it up to 100% and make a lot more volume of air bubbles. And you could argue more air is better or less air is better. You know, hey, you got to aerate it somehow. And I would generally say more air, and I would personally like to have more air than this pump is currently putting out on this shady day. However, this is what Seth does, and by the results he's getting, it looks like it's working to me. Could it work better if you put more aerated? We don't know. We'll have to test that one. Now, the other setup he's got, you guys can see he's got an empty bucket here with just water in it, and he's got a really cool setup here. So this is basically how he distributes his compost tea. Super simple, super easy. This rock on here is just to keep this weighted down, and this is just this little sediment filter. This is a siphon. So literally, this is just a little filter so that particulate doesn't go in there. When he turns his water hose on, and of course, he's filtering his water through the Boogie Blue Plus water filter, another very important component for living soil. You don't want to make and invest in your living soil and then kill your soil because you're using city water that has chlorine in it. That is designed to kill the microbes, right? So he's filtering the water, and you can see this, basically this tube is a siphon valve that is an add-on for his hose. So anytime he waters, he basically will turn this on, and the once he puts this in the compost tea, when it's done, it'll basically suck up the compost tea through this hose and inject it into the watering line, and that's when he waters his plants. And it'll take some amount of time for him to basically siphon out all this and dilute it into the water as he waters. So that's kind of ingenious. I just like to take basically a hand can of like watering, put my tea in here and then just water it out. And then I'll actually go back and, you know, water it in. So yeah, he does it a little bit differently. So that's kind of cool. I mean, this kind of makes it a lot more seamless. You don't have to deal with the watering can. You can be like, oh, my tea's done. I'm just gonna go ahead and water my garden now and distribute the tea. So that's kind of cool. All right, so now the next part of this video is, I don't want to scare you guys, but you know, Seth here uses a lot of different amendments. Now here's the thing, guys, you guys don't need to buy all these amendments to have an amazing garden. You know, there are some selected amendments and things that I think people should use to basically up their game. Maybe Seth, like me, maybe goes a little bit overboard and buys like extra stuff to really make sure it's cool. But you guys, honestly, I mean, for just like this one extra thing, it might make it go up that much better, right? But there's some base things that I definitely wanna encourage you guys to get. And we're gonna go over, you know, just some of the products that he has, and I'm gonna show you guys what they are and why they may be important for you. So over on this side of the table, we've got a lot of the products from the Boogie Brew Company, one of my favorite companies, and I've set up a special discount code you guys could use at Boogie Brew. It is boogiebrew.net/GYG to get the John Kohler Growing Your Greens hookup prices that I've negotiated with the Boogie Brew team to get you guys the best prices on some of these very products. Of course, Seth uses the insect frass, This is the 311 OMRI listed down to earth. Good for adding some nutrients to the soil, but also help to prevent the pests. Of course, he's also got the Boogie Humus, which is a product I like. Actually, this latest Boogie Humus is really nice, rich, and black. The best shipment they've ever got, in my opinion. He's also got the Caliwana castings, and this is the Boogie Brew castings that are some of the best castings in the market for sure. He's also got the Boogie Brew compost tea. This is your base, guys. If you guys don't buy anything else on this table, you guys gotta get the Boogie Brew compost, right? And if you guys are so cheap, you don't wanna buy the Boogie Brew compost, that's all right. Josh is cool, the owner of Boogie Brew. I made a video with him, I'll post a link down below, where he shares his open source compost tea recipe. Now, he's always tweaking that and improving it and making it better all the time, but that gives you the basis of what you guys need to source and all the ingredients you need to buy separately to make something like he makes in the Boogie Brew compost tea. I don't wanna go out and have to reinvent the wheel and play with compost teas and buy all these ingredients and put them together. So I personally use the Boogie Brew compost tea myself. And if you're a heavy user like I am, you wanna get the Boogie Brew Black Ops box. And that's when you get the private label stuff or the unlabeled stuff, because he sells it in bulk and it's a lot cheaper. All right, so other products that he uses here is the Boogie Black. Now this stuff is no longer available. This is a collector's item but hopefully it's gonna come back pretty soon. And then also we got things like the water soluble amino acid powder. So this is like the soy aminos you guys can add to your garden. Of course, better than the soy aminos, what I personally use myself. And this is what, you know, if you can't buy the compost tea or you don't want to, you gotta get this stuff minimally. I mean, this is the other thing on the table that I recommend above all else. Probably I'd say after the compost tea, Josh might say, get this before you even get the compost tea. This is the pure protein, the fish hydrolysate. This stuff will make a huge difference in your garden, guys. Like, I always use it in the springtime right after I plant my transplants, and you know, maybe every few weeks as a foiler and soil drench, and it makes my plants go crazy. Of course, Seth used a lot of other different products, including a soluble seaweed powder. You know, soluble powders are easier to ship, and this one was purchased from Amazon. He purchased a lot of stuff from Amazon. Of course, he's got the Dakota Rev organic growth stimulant. This is new for this year. He hasn't even used this yet. He's got the mustard seed meal. This may be good for like fungus nests. We have an outbreak, along with other different natural remediation methods. Mustard seed meal. Oh, this is the stuff he likes a lot. The Stonington blend organic plant food with lobster, kelp, and worm castings 524. So this one, just reading it, I'm like, you know what? You guys need to have like lobster and more stuff from the ocean put into your garden, because a lot of gardens don't get the impact or the nutrients or the different, you know, chitin from the ocean, you know, crab meal and lobster shells and all these things, so valuable. And then moving over, another one of his favorite companies is the Build a Soil, and this is the Craft Blend Nutrient Pack. Of course, I visited this company in Texas, link down below for that video, when I went years ago, the Micro Life Fertilizer. I love this Micro Life Fertilizer. I don't use it anymore, but this stuff is bomb if you're looking for a singular fertilizer. Of course, before I bought the Micro Life, I would get the Pure Protein one-stop shop right in this one. This is a lot easier. And this also, I like that the Pure Protein also has some bacteria in there, so it'll kill like little kind of worms and whatnot, like cabbage worms and whatnot on your plants. Of course, for some living soil, you also need some mycorrhizal fungi. As much as I love the worms and the castings he's making here, we've got some granular mycorrhizal fungi. And here's a different microbe complete biological soil inoculant. And here's another biofoss soil inoculant from Rootwise as well. And then, you know, Seth is like, dude, if you got to buy a bag of soil, this is like the best soil. You can do your whole grow with just this soil. And this is the artisanal living soil blend 3.0 recipe. This stuff got a lot of things in there, man. This is some of the best stuff. Oli Mountain Fish compost. Hey, I use that stuff myself. You can get that at a grocery store, actually. The Build a Soil number one, worm castings, Build a Soil, big trace minerals with humic acid. Anyways, there's a lot of stuff in this, guys. And here's the thing. as much as the soil may be some of the best stuff out there to grow your plants, the issue I have with it is that you gotta it gotta be shipped to you, right? My goal is to make and buy all the amendments that they put in here and then add it to your own compost or local compost that you find on site to basically make your own soil so that you have to ship soil all over the country as good as any soil is. And if you guys want to make your own good soil, you know, something else you guys should use is the hemp protein powder that's raw ingredient. This is a new product that is not really talked about using in living soil blends, but I'll be sure to have another video with actually Josh and Seth coming up on my channel. So make sure you click that subscribe button right down below where we're going to talk a lot more about this hemp protein powder to use in soil to make your soil even better. And the other thing that I wanted to talk to you guys about is, like, you know, Seth doesn't just feed his worms just the regular compost that he's making. He also went out of his way to buy, I think probably from Amazon once again, a special worm chow. Now, he bought this worm chow and he's like, he kind of felt scammed after he bought it. He's like, this is not the best worm chow. And he's hoping that some company will come out with a worm chow. I mean, the thing is this, right? Your worm castings are only as good as what the worms are eating. And yes, his worms are eating some really good food here and the carbon and all this stuff. But the challenge is you could add things into the, you know, the compost to feed your worms to basically take it up to the next level. That's what they do at places like OGS. Link down below to that video so you guys could see what they feed their worms, right? And I think a company should come together with a mix, a natural mix, including crab and kelp and oyster shell meal and all different kinds of foods to basically feed the worms to basically take up the biology that they poop out even better. But this was the best he could find, but he's not gonna be buying this again. So you guys can see he uses lots of different products here. Once again, two most important ones, pure protein and the compost tea for sure. The last part of this episode I want to do for you guys is we're gonna sit down with Seth and interview him and talking about his living soil and his methods of growing the cannabis along with his vegetables. So now I have the pleasure of introducing you guys to Seth of Teal Farms, or actually as Josh of Boogie Brew, my friend of me likes to call him Super Seth, and we're gonna ask him some questions so that you guys can become more familiar with this amazing gardener right here, growing some amazing stuff, creating some amazing living soil. So Seth, the first question I have for you is, how long ago did you get into gardening?
So I've been gardening just about my whole life. I would always help my parents out in the vegetable garden. And then in high school, I took like this ecology class that I loved, and we learned all about germinating seeds, all about how to re-amend soil and stuff like that. I got super into that. And then when I was in college, I was a landscaper at UC Santa Cruz, and we did a bunch of like native species restoration and stuff like that. So like we would like take a hillside and try to remove all the bad weeds from it. And then we would plant like native sages and stuff in there. And I learned a lot about, you know, transplanting and basically everything having to do with organic gardening while I was a landscaper there. So then I graduated and I wanted to keep growing. And so now, you know, every place I've lived since then, I've grown a bunch of vegetables and I've grown my own cannabis. And I also like to grow my own like cooking herbs and everything like that.
Cool. So how long ago did you start growing cannabis, and did you always grow cannabis using a living soil like you are now?
Yeah. So I'm 30 now. I started growing when I was 19. So I've been growing cannabis for 11 years, and I have not always grown living soil. I've always kind of been on the more organic side of things, but the real like living soil style where you've got like giant beds of soil and stuff, that I started doing more like 3 or 4 years ago. I saw people just like doing it on YouTube and it looked awesome. And when I'm growing, you know, I'm all about the terpenes, I'm all about the taste, I'm all about the feeling that you get when you're using the cannabis. And so I think living soil is like the pinnacle of that. So 3 or 4 years ago, I decided I was gonna start more pursuing the living soil aspect of growing, not just the organic side of growing, if that makes sense.
Yeah, so like to me, living soil is beyond organic, because organic is just basically a standard that tells you guys what you can't do. It doesn't say what you should do to actually grow high quality stuff, right? So I wish like that every farm that grows vegetables and other things, right, did a living soil, or maybe you could call it living, people want to call it maybe regenerative, I don't, you know, all these words. But what's really important to me is like, let's define this, and what does it really mean? What do you add in the soil? What are your criteria for having good soil? So Seth, because you've grown like organically and then went into a living soil, what have you noticed you know, a difference in your end result of your flower from your cannabis or your vegetables growing from like strict organic and then now moving into a living. What differences have you seen, and has it been beneficial and worthwhile to pursue this living soil thing that many people may hear about, but they don't really understand so much?
So the main difference I see is the terpenes in the cannabis seem to express themselves a lot more in living soil. And that's really what I'm after, like I was saying. So, you know, organic is great. And that's kind of like bare minimum as far as I'm concerned for gardening. And then living soil, like you're saying, is kind of the step above that. I think the plants just seem happier. You know, that term turgor, they seem to have just like, they're stoked. The leaves are praying up towards the sun. You know, if you see that, like when your leaves are like this up towards the sun, that means that the plants are like really happy and they're growing. I see a lot of that. I see more in living soil than I did when I was growing organically. And then, yeah, the terpenes is the bottom line. Like the taste is just, is there with the living soil cannabis, where it's not necessarily there with any other style that I've messed with.
So the terpenes are there. So then explain that to somebody like me. Like I don't like smoke the cannabis, mm-hmm. but like if I taste it, would it like burn my tongue more because there's more terpenes or what? Like what's going on there? And then how does that affect you? Like when you use it, is it taste? Does it affect like the feeling you get or what? Like,
so as far as I understand, terpenes are what you're tasting. They're like the, it's like a lot of the things in cannabis, it's not just THC, it's not just CBD. There's the so-called entourage effect where there's like 500 different active chemicals within the cannabis plant. And all of those things together give you that feeling when you use cannabis. It's like, it's not just the THC that you're feeling. It's not just the CBD, it's everything. And so the terpenes are a part of that. They will increase flavor, and they'll also like, you know, increase some of those trace things in the cannabis that you don't always get from, you know, just focusing on THC or just focusing on CBD or any of that. And so the terpene is like, it's kind of like, it's almost like a perfume or something. Like it's what you smell, it's what you taste. And it's like, it's part of the chemical of the cannabis plant.
Yeah, I mean, I think that's where really the magic is like in the terpenes as well as all the other micronutrients in the cannabis besides the cannabinoids. And unfortunately, as I rant about in my channel a lot, is that like, you know, growers have been basically growing for the THC cannabinoid, which is one small component of all the different 500 different compounds in a cannabis plant, which is quite insane. And then they just use growing methods to like make the most amount of THC, including breeding methods, which I think is quite sad when we're losing terpenes, we're losing different cannabinoids in high levels because we're favoring THC. So a living soil, in my opinion, is a way to bring back some of the other components of the cannabis to have a more fully expressed plant, and then more, a fully expressed, you know, when we take the plant and ingest it, however we choose to do it. So yeah, I'm all with this living soil, and that's really why I wanted to share with you guys what Seth is doing, a lot different than other cannabis grows in the past. And I hope a lot of you guys that are growers, even people that just grow vegetables and legal to do so in your state, just start growing cannabis along with your vegetables, right? So Seth, you want to talk about why do you grow cannabis like literally in your raised beds with your vegetables? Because really most people just grow cannabis like alone or with themselves because they're like, I don't want to get any contamination. Like the aphid from this plant might go to my cannabis and I don't want to risk it. Or like, why do you do it so much differently than other people I've seen?
Well, I think the main reason I do it is because this is just where I have the space, and I'm going to grow my own vegetables for sure. And if I'm going to grow my own cannabis, then I'm just going to interplant them with the vegetables. The other thing I've noticed is that when you've got all these different plants going around, it's like you're not going to have these like crazy infestations where the same bug takes over every single plant. It's like if you've got corn aphids and all you have is corn, then you just have corn aphids on everything. But if you've got corn aphids, but you've only got a few corns on the side, and then you've got some cannabis over here, some lettuce over here, those same aphids might not attack all these different plants. So monocultures are very susceptible to, you know, the like one pest just wiping out the whole thing. Whereas like here, I don't really have that many issues like that. So that's one big reason. It's like, if you've got a real ecosystem, a lot of the time the ecosystem will take care of itself. Yeah. Which is rad. You know, that's like the best part about the whole thing is, you know, I'm out here, I've got my cannabis plants in the ground, and if I'm hungry, you know, I got the munchies, I just,
right? You got the munchies right after you got the munchies from the cannabis.
Exactly. a bit of a self-fulfilling prophecy. It's like, I get the munchies and I've got the salt right here, so.
And you just need some guacamole to dip the snap peas in or some hummus. Mm-hmm. Then you're totally golden.
Right.
All right, cool. Yeah, and the other thing is that he also does integrated pest manager or IPM techniques as well. So he's interplanting things like marigolds and different flowers in here.
Calendula.
And different calendulas and other plants that could act as a repellent, you know. Garlic and onions and different kind of herbs could definitely throw off the scents of different bugs, right? And I mean, even cannabis. Cannabis also has a scent, and is that there for us because we love the smell like I do, you know, of it fresh, not when it burns. I don't like the smell of cannabis burning. I like the fresh smell. But also, you know, that will prevent bugs. Like, bugs would be like, oh, I don't like that cannabis smell. Like, actually, I was talking to a girl last night. She doesn't like the cannabis smell. And I'm like, oh, I love that smell so much. But anyways, yeah, so I mean, this is really, I think, the way to move forward, especially if you're just growing for personal use, is to just grow it along with your vegetables, because it's just another herb or plant that can be used. You know, once again, I like to use it in salads. You could juice it. You could blend it into green smoothies, all your trim leaves, and while you're waiting for the flowers to occur. I want to ask you more about the living soil. Like, really, what are the secrets? Like, if somebody turns this video off now, like, what do you think everybody out there should do to create a more living soil? And going beyond organic, like, what are the specific practices that you do? I know you buy a lot of different things, you know, and things to add to the soil. But honestly, people don't really need to do that if they just do some things that'll just bring their garden to be more and have more living soil and more microbes and earthworms like Seth does. When you move it aside, there's like a bunch of worms you see.
Yeah. So I think one thing is adding a lot of organic matter to the soil is super helpful. So like, you know, like John was saying, every time I clip my lawn, I throw the lawn shavings on that, and like the worms go crazy for that, but also it acts as a mulch and all that. So number one would be add a lot of organic matter. You know, every time you're taking down an old bush, you just like, you know, tear it up into pieces and chuck it on the soil. And then eventually that'll just get integrated into the soil and it'll be worm food. And by the time it's done being worm food, it's the best soil in the world. So, yeah, one big thing, add a lot of organic matter. I would say feeding with compost tea, keeping those microbes happy. I also think aeration is great. You know, like I've got rice hulls and perlite and pumice in my soil. A lava rock can also help with aeration. And what that does is it allows the roots to really get down in there. And when they need it, they need oxygen. You know, they need both water and oxygen, just like humans. And so if you've got the right amount of aeration, that's going to help a lot with the, you know, the roots getting what they need.
So what percentage of different kind of rice hulls and perlite and the volcanic rock stuff do you like add in there, you know, to help out with your aeration?
So the Master Coots says you take 1/3 compost, 1/3 aeration, and 1/3 like a pit moss or a cocoa core or any of that. So I do try to aim for about 1/3 of aeration. And that's pretty easy because a lot of the time aeration should be the cheapest part of your grow, you know? Yeah. It's like you want to, if you really want to ball out, get good compost. And then, you know, you can ball out on great aeration. Like lava rocks can be pretty expensive. Pumice can be pretty expensive. But a lot of the time I'm just using perlite because I've got big beds to fill and it's super
cheap. I get 4 cubic, you know, foot bags for, I don't even know, $15 or something insane.
Yeah, it's cheap.
And then the rice hulls also could be used that will, you know, break down over time, unlike the...
Yeah, and rice hulls are great because not only do they give you aeration, but it also is organic matter. And when worms eat them, they can digest that and provide your plants with silica, because there's silica in rice hulls. And that's
great for the
immune
system. Silica
is a very
important nutrient for the plants, for their backbone. We have, you know, calcium in our bones, but the plants need the silica, which is something that may be missing out of some gardens. Mm-hmm. So Seth, I want to talk about the compost tea, because that, to me, that's foundational. How often do you apply the compost tea? They saw your compost tea set up, how you basically feed it through your hose. How often do you feed the compost tea?
So I'm feeding compost tea probably once every 10 days, maybe once every 14 days. But a lot of the time I'm feeding very low and slow. And if I'm doing it really low and slow, like with that siphon setup, that I'll do relatively often. Like I'll do that almost every time I water, just because it's so diluted that you're not going to burn your plants or anything. It must be diluting it something like 1 gallon for every 50 gallons of water.
Wow,
it's
that's
super
that's
low.
A super insane that to me, that's diluted too much. But if you're doing it every time, you're doing it every time, like that's kind of cool. You could always have it kind of running. And when you're watering, you could always just spray it out. That's cool.
So I don't know if it's exactly 1:50 or whatever ratio it is, but it is very diluted to the point where I've never had an issue overfeeding compost tea. It's just like adding compost to the top of it. You know, it you can be pretty aggressive with it because the compost is not going to burn your plants the way that, for instance, like a synthetic nitrogen might.
Yeah, I mean, well, I've never had problems like basically brewing compost tea full strength, put it in like a watering can and then watering on my plants. I've never burned plants that way either. Mm-hmm. So, I mean, it's highly unlikely that you're going to have issues with compost tea. But of course, once I water it in full strength, then I basically then go back and water it in with my hose to like make sure it drenches in and just doesn't evaporate in my climate. So then the other question is, I didn't see an irrigation system here. Do you just hand water this garden or how do you get water to it?
Yeah, so right now it's all hand watering, but I think later on this season when it warms up a little bit, I might set up like a drip irrigation system. But for now, I'm super happy with hand watering and the plants don't seem to mind at all. The plants, you know, I don't have any regular schedule for watering or anything. I'll dig down in the soil. If I go an inch deep and the soil is dry, then that's when I water.
Yeah, I mean, honestly, guys, like, hand watering is probably the best way to water because you could judge when your plants need the water. In some climates, like my climate, it would not be practical because it's so arid and so hot in the summer. I would have to be out there so often, and so I use a drip system. But you know, I think when you're hand watering, you're kind of watering the whole space, so you're getting water everywhere. Mm-hmm. So it's more evenly distributed, like rain would be, which is the ultimate water for your garden. So I think actually that could take you up to the next level, because when you're drip watering, generally, you're dripping in certain locations, the same location every time. So that's mm-hmm. why maybe overhead watering could be better because you could, you know, get a better spread of the water to, once again, create a better living soil. Because if you're just watering one area of your garden, that area might have living soil, but as it gets more dry in a different area, you know, then that area is not going to be as alive.
To dry out. But also, you don't want to irrigate cannabis from above. You always want to be irrigating the cannabis on the soil itself and usually not getting the leaves wet.
Ah, so you got to really, unlike vegetable, even with vegetables, you really don't want to get the leaves wet.
Mm-hmm.
That's
like
not
tomato,
the goal.
Right?
Yeah, like a tomato, you want to try to water only the soil. Mm-hmm. So he's really paying attention to the watering and where it's being directed and going. All right, Seth, so who inspired you as gardeners? Because I know you've been doing this a long time. You went to, you know, university to learn about, you know, gardening and restoration and ecology, but who do you follow online, you know, for information that you get to incorporate? Because, you know, much like me, I don't just like follow one specific model. I like look at what some of the best people are doing and pull this component, that component from different people and then make it my own, try stuff, see what works. If it works, continue with it. If it doesn't work, hey, I'll try something else.
Yeah. So obviously one of the big ones is GYG. I'm a longtime viewer. And then, you know, the boogeyman himself, Josh, has been a big inspiration in the garden. Build a Soil, the guy Jeremy out in Colorado, he is a huge inspiration to me. I watch just about all his videos, including like the stuff at the Build a Soil Family Farm, which I think is awesome. And then, man, there's so many great YouTube channels. Mr. Grow It is a really good one. He does mostly cannabis, but he'll do anything, and he's growing in soil. He's growing soil indoors. The dude Steve Cantwell, kind of near you, I think he's in Nevada. He has possibly the coolest no-till setup in the world. I think the only people that might rival him are the No-Till Kings down in Southern California. They're also doing indoor no-till cannabis, living soil. And then as far as like outdoor growers that I like, Queen of the Sun Grown is super badass. She's doing a lot of good free education online, and she's also, you know, she's like at conferences, and I know she's got an interview with Josh that's coming out soon, which will also be cool. So yeah, Queen of the Sun Grown's a badass. You know, anyone sharing good information online is welcome in my book, right? You know, I'm not picky.
Right on. Cool. Yeah, I encourage you guys to like look up some of those channels and learn more about creating a living soil. I'm all for living soil for sure. I mean, it's just the way that nature would grow. And it's the way of the future. So Seth, before we sign off today, like, how can somebody get a hold of you if they have questions or want to see about what's going on, what you're doing in your garden?
Cool. So that would be awesome if you guys want to reach out. My Instagram handle is Teal Farm Garden. That's TEALFARMGARDEN, just Teal Farm Garden. And that's where I post all the updates about this garden. And I also, you know, I post everything there, like my dogs and my awesome garden and whatever else that's going on back here in my backyard.
Right on. Cool. So yeah, follow Seth at Teal Farm Garden. Yeah. I'll put a link down below in the description for you guys. So if you guys enjoyed this episode and want more videos at Seth's place, hey, please be sure to give this video a thumbs up. I could do like monthly visits like I did with TD so you guys can see the progress of his plants and what's going on and how he continues to build his soil and create a more resilient system to grow his vegetables along with his cannabis in the same living soil raised beds. Also, be sure to share this video with somebody else that's been growing cannabis with chemicals or even cannabis organically, how they could basically use some of these practices that I've shared with you guys today to take their garden to the next level, to create more terpenes, to create happier plants, and even to grow some vegetables at the same time. And all Americans need to eat more fresh fruits and vegetables because they're really the best. All right. If you guys enjoyed this episode and want to watch more episodes from me, make sure you click that subscribe button right down below so you don't miss my new and upcoming episodes. I've come in every 5 to 7 days. You never know, shrimp or what you'll be learning on my YouTube channel. And make sure you click the little bell so you get notified as many videos come out. And finally, be sure to check our past episodes. The past episodes are a wealth of knowledge. Over 1,600 episodes on this channel at this time dedicated to teach you guys all about how to grow the healthiest fruits and vegetables as well as cannabis on the planet. So with that, my name is John Kohler with growingyourgreens.com. We'll see you next time. And until then, remember, keep on growing.